Hey, Major Crimes fans, I have a special interview for you today. I am here with Phillip Keene and KEARRAN GIOVANNI. You know them better as Buzz and Amy. We are going to talk all things Major Crimes and all things PanAm as well. It's always fun to see you two. We got to talk back in July, and there have been some updates because now the season is almost over. And last night, we had a big episode for you, didn't we?
Absolutely, yeah, we did. I had kind of a hard time connecting to the material, and I didn't understand why until after we were halfway through it. A lot of the character traits of one of the people in the episode are very reflective of one of my family members, so I wasn't really hitting the marks on everything, and I couldn't figure out why until afterwards.
I think we all knew.
Yeah.
And he was like, I just don't understand why I'm having such a hard time. And we're like, okay, we're going to let them figure this out
themselves. Yes, exactly.
But it was very obvious to the rest of us.
Yeah. And James actually had a hand in writing some of this. And he did it on purpose, actually, in a way to kind of bring me out of my funk. So I was having some difficulties with a family member. And this was a way to introduce that into the story and make it real. Mm-hmm. So
I don't know if I'd love the idea of knowing that my life is just going to be out there so that, hey, I will get out of my funk.
When you live with a writer, anything you say is fair game, so you have to be careful what you say.
So do you ever say, this is off limits? Or do you expect that James will know that?
I expect that James will know that.
It's interesting that KEARRAN says all of them noticed that you were in a funk. So what was going on?
That old saying, you can't see the forest for the trees. Mm-hmm. Because I was so deeply in what was happening, seeing it there on the page, it was confusing and upsetting. And I didn't know why I was having those reactions until after I talked to my friends about it.
Yeah, because it wasn't exactly, you know, word for word or situation exact, but it was clearly a reference to what he was going through. The difference, obviously, she's a cop, and you know, your aunt's not a cop, and, you know, her family is a little bit different than your family, but...
Well, my family's crazier, I think.
That'll be written in next season.
Yeah, exactly, yes.
But her personality
was
very much the same.
Yeah, very much so.
And so is the fact that this person was the victim in the show, do you think that made it even more real to you or made it even more emotional?
I think so, yeah. But I think it was just more about the way she treated her family. That's what really hit home for me.
I think this character also, you know, most people that act this way usually see themselves as a victim. So I think in writing her as a victim, it's more of how she actually feels as a person. So
most
it has that, you know, kind of undertone of that. So
yeah, just lots of frustration and irritation. And I didn't understand why I was so angry throughout this episode.
That's all right.
It's all over now. Yes, yes.
Until next season when something else personal comes in.
I know. I'm always like, should I
life?
Tell them what's going on in my life or not?
Because it's going to be there.
Speaking of personal life and relationships, though, your character, Amy, also has some relationships going on, or relationship. I mean, last time I spoke to you in July, Malcolm Jamal Warner had been on as your love interest. And do you think we'll be seeing more of him?
I hope so. You know, Malcolm is just, it's so great to have him on the show. And it was honestly
such a great energy.
A dream of mine to have him on. So I feel very lucky that we are paired up. He's just been really busy this season, luckily doing other projects and things like that. So hopefully, yes, he'll be back. I know he wants to be back. He actually texted me.
Oh, did he?
Yep. Okay. Beginning of this last eight, and we had a new character who joined the show, a very attractive young man, and he texted me and was like, what happened? Like, are you, what's going on? Like, was I replaced? Like, who's this guy? And I'm like, no. We had a whole conversation about it, and it's funny how that's exactly what his mind jumped to. It was like, what? You're my girlfriend. So, yeah, hopefully he will be back. It's a pleasure.
And I imagine for you getting a text from him, because when we spoke before, we were both a little excited, like, Theo is your boyfriend.
I know. I still, like, can't, when people go, oh, do you have a love interest on the show? I'm like, yeah, it's Malcolm Jamal Warner. I do. I'm thrilled to have him.
I'm happy for you. I think that's great that you have a love interest, and Provenza's gotten married, and there's this whole Shandy thing, and Rusty has Gus, and, Sanchez has his ex-wife, and he's had a couple of other, you know, flirtations in the past, and Tao is married.
What are you trying to say?
I'm just saying, you know, Buzz is a little lonely. I think he needs a companion.
Buzz does need a companion.
Besides his bike.
besides his bicycle and his job. Yeah. Now that he's cleared up this whole cold case with his dad and uncle's murder, it's time for him to live a little, I think.
I think Buzz at one point had a little crush on Amy.
He did.
Like when I got the flowers that time when I started dating Malcolm, he had this little sad puppy dog face in the background the whole scene, and he's like, I think Buzz is really a little upset.
Yeah, we did have a talk. We did have a discussion about that.
Yeah, we had a discussion about your character.
Yeah. Almost every woman who comes through, whether she's a killer or she's an attorney, I'm thinking, oh, well, there's a person that Buzz could, you know, go out with. So, but it doesn't happen.
Like, there's my chance.
Not too late. We got many seasons left.
Exactly.
That's right. And congratulations, because you guys were recently picked up for number 6, which is fantastic.
We have an order for 13, and that's how it was last year and the year before, and then they kept adding more episodes. So hopefully that will happen again.
And for the writers, that's a little bit difficult, knowing where do I make the ending.
Exactly.
And your season this year was split up. We had a few months off before you came back for the end.
What they don't realize is we get breaks a little bit, but when they added these extras, they weren't definitely not completely prepared. So we had a 6-week hiatus in September that for us, we were like,
it was great, but the writers have to, you
know, for them, they're like,
they've got to break stories and create them, and then we've got to, you know, do the casting. Every episode takes from beginning to end 72 days to complete.
When you guys first get the scripts, do you go to each other and say, oh, good, look, we're in this scene together, or we haven't had many scenes together, I missed you?
Definitely.
I think it depends on what it is, but anytime.
We're excited about, oh my God, I get to work with you, or we have this moment, or it's a really cool thing to do.
Yeah, and there was a scene or something this season that I think we were actually in. It was just maybe the two of us or us and one other person, and we were like,
oh my gosh, there's a moment.
Together.
Yeah.
And also, you know, like Buzz's, your interrogation scenes, when you're in a cast that's so large and you've got, you know, it's really about just fitting everyone in. You know, you've got to fit a lot into, you know, our show, or
42 and a half minutes.
So when you have something like, you know, Buzz's storyline and how he got to do that interrogation scene and really show how hard he's been working and where, you know, on the case and as an actor, I think it was very gratifying.
It was
really exciting for us, too, because we are such a family that there's never like a, why are they getting this or are they getting that? It's really like,
everybody has their moment.
Go. Like, you know, we're better if we're all better.
Yeah.
You know, it's great.
Which is important. And this season, we have definitely seen what happened last week, the big proposal that I think so many fans
were waiting for.
Yes.
The blog just blew up, I think.
So when you guys read that script, what was everyone's reaction? All the actors on set. What was everyone saying when you got it?
We knew it was coming eventually.
Yeah. I was more excited because can't wait for the wedding. Like, what does Amy get to do for the wedding?
Yeah, but Amy can't channel Kieran in this moment.
I know, I'd love to plan. I'm sorry. No, Amy probably does not really care because she doesn't want to get married. But
you would be great, though. I mean, Kieran put together this huge birthday party for me for my 50th this last year. So
it was super fun.
Yeah, it was.
And it had a very special theme, didn't it?
Yes, it did.
It was an airline.
A little interest in that I used to work for. Yeah.
It's coming to me.
I think.
A PanAm themed party.
Yeah.
Now, that sounds fabulous. And you had to decorate, right, for 3 days. Phillip got sent away.
A couple months in the planning, and James gave me an idea, and we kind of just ran with it. It was all his idea.
Kieran orchestrated and produced the most amazing. It was an event. It really was.
It was. It took 3 days. He had to leave because we had to literally
stay in the hotel.
Build out sets, and we did a jetway up the stairs outside, and people had to, you know, board a plane. So they went through security. They left their baggage, which were presents.
Yes.
We had real paraphernalia from PanAm come in, real airline security things come in.
They even went to the extreme of renting the costumes from the ABC show PanAm, and so all the young ladies who were serving were dressed as flight attendants. Yeah.
I mean, how fabulous, down to the every little detail.
Down to the napkins, which we are using.
Yes, we got those from the PanAm experience.
She actually helped plan my wedding as well.
Oh, really?
Yeah, because that's what she does.
It's plan.
Yeah.
I feel like all actors have, like, something else that they do, whether they do it as a career or they collect something. I don't know, I think we hyper-focus on a lot of things as actors, and mine is planning things. I love to plan things. I would plan something right now if I had a few extra minutes.
Yeah, well, Kieran makes lists of lists that she needs to make.
I love that.
But, you know, I leave them on my, you know, Amy's desk, and I'll make lists, you know, whatever. We're just sitting around in between setups, and I'll come back, and then someone will have written, like, you know, make another to-do list, or, like, give Sanchez $1 million, or, you know,
something silly
on the bottom of my list.
Was there a lot of pressure planning a wedding for your boss and co-star, who are also your friends?
I mean, yes, I want it to be great, but when we step out of work, we're just friends and family, and I think we love each other.
Yeah,
and
we hang out. I mean,
I know
like
their
this.
Taste.
Yeah.
And I wasn't alone in the wedding. Totally. We did it together.
Yes, because she asked me. She said, "Do you have a wedding planner?" And I thought, No, why do I it's need that? It's a party,
it's,
right?
You know, the getting everything together, and then the day of, you don't want to be stressed out going, you know, I need this or I need that. It's better if someone else kind of delegates the day. So I just helped.
She was fierce. We had a little incident when one of the circuit breakers blew outside, and she grabbed one of our ADs, who's now a director, and she said to him, go turn that on now. Go find it.
First of all, he got punished because he wore jeans.
Yeah, he's the only person who... He goes to a child's birthday party in a tuxedo and comes to our wedding in jeans.
So, you got to climb up there. That's your punishment. You're wearing jeans. You're the only one that can forge through the forest up there. Go. Go.
So she did, yeah. Everything was like clockwork. She was like Madonna with the headset, you know, talking to the dancers. So.
That is a great descriptive. Mm-hmm.
Being their face when you get to do something like that is... priceless. It was awesome.
So it sounds like Karen needs to be involved too with some of the categorization, some of the organization of your PanAm collection, because you have one of the largest collections. You have over 3,000 items, right?
I do. I think now maybe it's 3,500 pieces. Some just came today that I haven't even opened yet. So,
so we get to see first. Yes. Okay. One of them, I see three.
Okay.
It's, I know.
I don't even know what it is.
I'm so excited too. I feel like I'm getting a present. Like, what is it?
I have no clue what this is. Yet.
It says eBay.
Oh, this is for someone else, actually.
What is it?
A friend of mine, they used to work for Eastern, so I found these little butter dishes for them. So.
Of course you did.
These are nice, but that's not what I want to look at the moment.
By the way, he'll just show up at work and be like, I was just like doing this, and I found this thing that I think you would love. And literally, exact to taste, every single person that he's like the fairy godmother of set.
Okay, the big box.
Okay, we'll see what's in
there. We always know the big box is the best, right?
Like you said, I didn't know what was going to be in these.
A bag.
There's that, which is cool.
And so what's the story behind the bag? Is this a flight attendant bag? Who would carry
this? Flight attendant could have used it, but this would have been sold in one of the shops adjacent to the airport.
So a gift bag.
And then there's another one here. Oh, were you keeping that?
Yes.
Then these were
meal
kits that if you wanted to sleep on the flight, they would do a pre-prepared sort of box lunch for you or dinner.
So like if you were going to sleep through your meal, this would just be put on your
tray. Through the whole 3-hour dinner service that we used to do.
Okay.
And 7 carts and china and silver and linen and all that kind of stuff. So
was the 3-hour dinner service for first class only or
first
for everyone?
First class, business class probably took 1.5 or 2 hours. But
wow.
First class was 3 hours.
And it's funny too, because this feels to me like surprisingly flimsy.
Actually, I just had food in it, would sit in the meal cart.
I don't know. It looks very sturdy to me.
Mm-hmm.
Like it looks metal.
So yeah, exactly.
So I was expecting something metal. Yeah. Yeah. Okay.
And then this is a purser's wallet that we would carry. And so we had to carry $50 in change. Because back then you didn't have credit cards on the airplane. Okay. You paid everything with cash and not just dollars, but all the European currencies and the Asian currencies. And so we had little converters that we had to look at and try to make change for people. So that was a bit challenging. So all the different currencies we would carry in that.
So when you were flying internationally, let's say you were flying to Japan.
Yes.
Would you have to have American dollars and Japanese yen? Or would you have to have additional currencies just in case? And how many would you know to have?
We would get everything. And so we would make change with whatever change we had. Typically in U.S. dollars, we try to make change.
So you wouldn't necessarily give back in the same currency that you received?
Not necessarily, unless we had it. Another little...
So what is this? This reminds me of like a seat cover, pillow cushion.
I think this is a... This.
Another bag!
Isn't that cool?
That's very convenient.
Yeah. So, the duffel bag.
And so would this be something flight attendants would carry, or is this also from the gift shop?
This is probably from the gift shop.
If I wanted to buy like a bag, where would I even go?
Stores, you can find a lot of those.
Remember,
things.
And then we went to antiquing in Pasadena.
And we found those luggage labels.
Yeah. Did we get stamps?
I think we did get stamps.
There were PanAm stamps?
Yes, actually.
The planes, right?
Yeah, in fact, there's one down there underneath. But this was a first issue on this. So this is the 1970s, so the introduction of the jumbo jet, or the 747, which is now being phased out. So you've got the first cover stamp here, and then it was replicated in gold.
This is what I love about your collection, is that there are so many items that you wouldn't even think about. Mm-hmm. Like, I had no idea there were PanAm stamps, and one of the things we talked about before were the stir sticks that were made of plastic, and that was when plastic was first introduced, even.
Early on, in the 1930s and 40s, I think they had Bakelite before that, but plastic became a lightweight alternative to metal and things, so they would use them for to reduce the weight on the aircraft. So there were full sets of dishes made to replicate the china pieces, and then the stir sticks were new as well. So.
And that's amazing that it's to save weight. Mm-hmm. And how much weight then the dishes must have had to them.
Yeah, because they were made out of china or stoneware. Right. And you know, you get 50 or 60 plates on it. Try and carry that.
Right. Yeah,
and
no, then, it makes sense.
Then all the magazines, and the blankets, and the pillows, and it all adds up.
Not made out of the paper that they're made out of now.
Exactly.
Made out of actual real material.
Yes, yeah. I've got a few examples in the back over there.
So. Oh, good. Well, we'll have to take a look. Okay. And so we've got one more thing that came in another package that Karen opened.
And PanAm had its fingers in a lot of pies, if you will. So one of the things that they did is that during the lead up to World War II, the Germans had a huge presence in South America, and they controlled a lot of the airlines there. And through some discussions with the U.S. government and PanAm, they said, why don't you go down there and build these airways and landing spaces so that we can have a presence down there. Mm-hmm. So I think the idea of war was becoming much more clear to people. So PanAm went down there and bought shares in all the different companies. So this was one of them there, which is Pan Air do Brasil, then Laxa, which is in Central America, the Argentinian airlines, virtually any country in South America, Pan Am had a stake in that national carrier.
So is this like a piece of stock? Like what is this, exactly?
This is an advertisement, maybe even a Christmas card, it looks like.
From one of the companies that Pan Am
had a stake
in. Exactly,
so this was their a subsidiary. Yeah.
Got it. We're talking about this amazing collection that you have, and clearly we've all flown a lot. Mm-hmm. What do you think it is about Pan Am that has inspired such passion, not just in you, but in all the employees? You guys still get together once a year.
We do, 30 years after the company's gone out of business. Very much like what happens on our set. We're a family. We spend a lot of time together, and like our executives who had a great vetting process to figure out who's going to work well with others, I think the airline did the same thing. So you bring a lot of people together that have the same aesthetic and the same ideals, and you just get along.
I've been very lucky to go to some of the Pan Am things with Phillip, and they still dress in uniform. There's still a pride. I mean, they showed videos at one of the Pan Am experiences that we went to, and you know, they still have tears in their eyes thinking about this time in their life, because it wasn't just a job.
It was a lifestyle.
In their life.
Exactly.
It wasn't just that they lost their job so quickly and it was just over. It's that flying is not this way anymore. You know, you're not sitting there on, you know, having lobster thermidor being served on china and treated like a, you know, a real person
rather than a customer, expensive.
Right. You know. Way of travel. It just doesn't happen anymore.
And you were talking about how everyone got the news that Pan Am closed down as well. So
yeah, I had flown, at that point I was based in Miami, so I was doing a lot of South America. And I came back on December 3rd of 1991 from Caracas, went to sleep, woke up in the morning, and the company had ceased to exist.
That's like something out of the movies,
yes,
where
exactly.
You find out that your company is gone.
Yes, you wake up, you know, you go to bed, that it's okay, then you wake up in the morning and it's gone.
Some people found out mid-flight.
Yeah, there were still people flying, you know, coming back home or wherever they might have been. They got the news. So, of course, they had to relay it to the passengers. And once the planes landed wherever they landed, everything was confiscated because the company didn't exist anymore. It was really, really... I think shocking for a lot of people.
I think it's if we were all to imagine going to work on a regular basis and suddenly they tell you, sorry, right in the middle of your workday, you're shooting a scene,
right.
Buzz maybe finally has a love interest,
and
sorry, you're going home.
Okay, let's not even put that out
there. It's so sad for so many reasons, But it was the loss of the family, really, the family aspect of that. And that's one of the great things about working with Kieran and the rest of the cast is that we really do rely on each other. We know we can rely on each other, and we spend a lot of time in each other's homes and with the families and just hanging out together. You know, they really did assemble a great group of people. So.
My husband's name happens to be Philip as well.
Yes.
So to my kids, he's the other Philip. Yeah. Mr. Philip, the other Philip, not my daddy Philip, the other Mr. Philip.
And spending a lot of time in each other's homes, Karen knows your collection of Pan Am memorabilia pretty well. So you must have some favorite things.
Back in the day in Pan Am, can I take you guys over
there? Yeah, let's go. Karen, you've got a favorite object that's in this corner.
Oh, I do. we travel with our pets, and nowadays, you know, they get a teeny tiny space, and you have to, like, put them under your seat, or they're in the back, and you're just always worried about them. But
We used to carry them in the cargo hold in a special area that was temperature controlled and pressurized. And these signs would be affixed to the sides of their kennels or cages, gave it a little more cachet, a little first class aspect.
Yeah, they got big cages, they could move around, they were fed well, you knew they were taken care of. They got to fly first class as well when we feel like our pets are first class. So
I love that the dog's tail is wagging. Wag marks. He's a happy dog.
I mean, imagine if first class is having lobster thermidor.
What's he having?
It's not too bad down there.
He's a king. He's wearing a crown.
Not too shabby.
We don't know if he's a male or female.
Yeah, exactly.
Right. Yeah, and Karen, you have another favorite item in this collection too, don't you?
So while we're waiting for Karen to pick out her favorite item, these are some of the things that you have coming up for display, right?
Exactly. I'm hoping to find a space where I can rent for a couple of months and put everything out and get it all cataloged and recorded, photographed.
The collection is actually in a museum.
Parts of it are. We opened our first exhibit at the Cradle of Aviation Museum in December of last year, and we are opening the second phase of our exhibit this November. Some of these pieces will be in there, and hopefully we're going to find a permanent home for everything. And I'm considering opening an exhibit later on this year to display everything that I have.
What in the collection will you want to display the most?
I think maybe the evolution of the uniforms over the years, because it's not just an outfit. I think it tells a story of what's going on socially. Prior to 1972, 74, women were still relegated to wearing skirts and dresses, at least for our company. That was the first time that our ladies were allowed to wear pants. We employed a lot of top designers, Don Loper, Edith Head, Evan Pacone, Adolfo. That speaks to greater social movements that were going on at the time. Any of these artifacts that we have here, you can look at them and appreciate them for what they are singly, but then you look at them in a greater historical context, it tells a bigger story.
All right, so in keeping in line with this whole mid-century design that's become really trendy right now, this is some actual china from the 1950s that we used to have on the aircraft. And this was designed by Raymond Loewy, and who was a big designer, not only of china, but of cars and wallpapers and furniture. And so, you know, we employed the best of the best for our passengers.
And what I love about this is that it looks like you could use it even today. It looks like it could fit into your home.
Absolutely. This is really highly collectible nowadays. I know there's another set of this that was issued for their 25th anniversary, but this is some of the original stuff that we used to have on the airplane. And there's even a little demitasse here. So we had coffee and espresso.
Of course.
On the plane. Yeah.
And tell me about the shaker.
Oh, this is a cocktail shaker that we would use, and this was typically used because of the time period. We mixed like this, and now they're more like this when they come out of a bottle.
A big difference.
Exactly. Things have changed a little bit.
They have changed, including uniforms. Mm-hmm. Karen, have you found your favorite item?
Oh, wow.
I love it.
This is amazing. So this is one of the designers I was talking about. This is the Don Loper from the early 1950s, and you can see that she's sporting the hat there with a little cloth-covered hat pin at the back. And look at just the tailoring on this. It's amazing. But when you have a model like this, you can't help but look at it. So,
It looks fabulous. And the designer designed for the Beverly Hills Hotel, even.
He did. He designed a wallpaper that's pretty famous. It's a banana leaf wallpaper. So it's really pretty cool. You can see it in the Beverly Hills Hotel, down at the coffee shop there.
A famous designer, a famous outfit.
A famous actress.
You took my line. Okay. You took my line. Yeah. I was going to say, and two famous actors. Karen, I know you have a flight to catch. So thank you, Phillip. Thank you, Karen, for letting me crash your home. This has been so much fun learning about the show, the collection. Can't wait to see you guys next season on Major Crimes. Thanks so much for joining us. I'm Zoe Hewitt. We'll see you next time.